Okay, I guess we can go see... yeah. Let's go talk to Miss Green. Ask her about, the man. 22nd February, St. Bartholomew's Hospital Recovery Ward. Mr. Naruhodo, I've just finished speaking with a doctor. It seems Miss Green is well enough to be discharged at last. This is good news, but hopefully just before she leaves. Oh! What is it? Miss Green! What was that? She clearly just hid something behind her back. What moment? I'll be with you in a jiffy. Oh, hello everyone. What are you all doing here? The doctor has said I can be discharged, so I'm just getting my things together. Miss Green, what were you just doing? Oh, nothing, really. I was just about to take some medicine the doctor prescribed for me, that's all. Well, we were hoping to have another quick chat with you, if that's alright. I don't really have anything else to tell you. Arrest her for concealing evidence. Alright, she's definitely behaving strangely. Let's see if we can't coax something out of her. Hospital discharge. It's wonderful news that you're going to be discharged, Miss Green. Oh, yes, I mean, thank you. Once people are better, the hospital staff don't want them lingering and wasting space. Not people like me, anyway. So, I don't think I should keep anyone waiting. I probably shouldn't stand around and chat. She certainly doesn't seem to be in the mood to talk, that's for sure. Miss Green, we were hoping to ask you about someone. Mr. Duncan Ross, you knew him, didn't you? Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh! What is that? Oh no! I'm so sorry! The bottles of medicine fell down when she did. Oh, Miss Green, are you alright? She's an alcoholic. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to startle you like that. No. No, it's alright. I just wasn't expecting it. But how do you know about Duncan? Mr. Ross has been writing a letter when he passed away. The landlord found it in his room. It was a very personal letter to you. It was at the art school. That's where I met Duncan. A year ago now. He was looking to fund his studies. He dreamt of being a professional artist one day. And the two of you became romantically involved? Yes, that's right. We were very much in love. We were engaged to be married, actually. That's why he decided to move into a cheaper room to save money for the wedding. And that's what led him to Mr. Garadib's. Yes, he told me he'd found the worst but cheapest room in the entire East End. And then, 1 month ago, that's when it happened. We're so terribly sorry, Miss Green. Well, it's all in the past now, I suppose. Poor Miss Green. She looks desperately sad. I'm starting to think that's just her look. But now I see that she has every reason to feel the universe is against her.
I do hope you won't think I'm being rude, but... Would you mind leaving me in peace now? I have to leave the hospital soon.
Oh, I'm so sorry. We didn't mean to hold you up. Of course, we'll be on our way... Mr. Naruhodo.
Surely you are not about to leave.
That's quite out of the question. Well, Mr. Sholmes, I didn't realize you were here.
But of course I was, my dear fellow. Watching intently from the shadows, as always.
Well, make your presence known next time. Mr. Sholmes, what's this about?
Something which occurs to me with some regularity, Miss Susato, is this. Why do detectives insist on such an ex post facto modus operandi? Why solve a case after it's happened? Instead of preventing a case before it happens. That is what sets a great detective apart. What do you mean? There's a case waiting to happen under our very noses, Mr. Naruhodo. So let us avert disaster. Let us prevent this case from ever happening. With nothing but careful observation. Alright. All the clues you need are set before you. You only need look, and you cannot fail to see.
You can do it, Mr. Naruhodo. I know you can.
What are we doing? Oh, I guess we're examining.
No! She was gonna do it! No!
That mouse seems to be dead. Look. I didn't notice it there before, did you? Did you?
I think perhaps it drank the medicine that spilled over the bottle. But that's... the bottle that Miss Green was about to drink from when we arrived.
You don't think... Ah, I see you've come to appreciate the true nature of this scene. That of a tragedy about to take place. Yes, I think it's falling into place. Miss Green, the contents of the bottle you had before has spilt out onto the floor. And the poor mouse that drank it has sadly died.
Oh.
I think it's clear that the bottle must have contained a powerful poison.
No, so sad.
Don't worry. I will tend to the mouse presently. Miss Green, were you intending to go the same way as that rodent? To take your own life?
Oh.
Once we'd left, you'd have put it in your lips again, wouldn't you? And taken the poison?
Miss Green, please! Please talk to us!
Nintendo doing more to acknowledge mental health than society ever would. Oh, man. It never feels as though this card must be relevant. I mean, when we first arrived, Miss Green was standing with it in her hand in what can only be described as a very tense atmosphere.
Yes, it may be very well related to whatever incident Mr. Sholmes believed was about to happen here.
Perhaps we should ask Miss Green about it. Suicide. 10 seconds later, and we would have arrived at a very different scene here. In all probability, we would not have enjoyed this most delightful conversation. Of course, perhaps it hasn't been quite so delightful from your perspective, Miss Green.
Actually, in a way, now that everything's out in the open, I feel like a weight has been lifted.
Tell me, how did you acquire that medicine?
Well, with this being in hospital and all, when the doctor comes to examine me in the mornings, he always leaves the medicine cabinet open for a while, so I snuck this out when he wasn't looking.
It conspicuously lacks a label. I wonder what it contains.
I'm afraid I don't really know, but I thought if I drank it, it might just stop the pain somehow.
Oh, please, Miss Green. Don't talk of such things. Well, it seems clear now that it contains poison.
Yes, that poor little mouse is proof of that. Oh, no. Oh, it's all my fault. What have I done?
I shall remove this to my office, Miss Green. I take it you have no objection?
No. None.
Neither the sender's name or the address appear to be written on the envelope or the card.
It arrived by post at my home the day before the incident that put me in the hospital here.
I have information regarding the death of Duncan Ross. Come to the Slug and Salad on Briar Road at 5 p.m. on the 17th. Don't tell anybody else about this letter or the meeting. It is a matter of utmost importance. Wait a minute. The 17th? Of this month? That's the day you were stabbed on Briar Road. And 5 p.m. is precisely the time when the incident occurred. Whoa, that's weird. The Slug and Salad, yes. A pub on the northern corner of Briar Road. Briar Road? Being the street that Mr. Gerdip's house is on. Does this mean that...
Yes, I'm sure you've guessed. That day when I was struck in the back by the knife. I was actually on my way to the Slug and Salad.
Goodness. So that's what you were doing on Briar Road that day.
I'm sorry, I didn't say anything before. I think... I really will have to ask you to excuse me now. I've told you everything.
Yes. I'm very sorry to have had to drag up such painful memories for you.
No, it's fine.
Miss Green. Please. Promises you won't try to do anything like that again.
Yes, don't worry. Your detective friend has a bolter now, anyway. And besides, I've been stabbed in the back and had a close shave with a bottle of poison, and I'm still here. I think I'm destined to see things through to the end. It might sound a little conceited, but, well, that's how all this has made me feel.
Leaving Miss Green and St. Bartholomew's behind, we made our way back to Baker Street with Mr. Sholmes. Well, it would appear we've reached the end of the investigative trail for today. Yes, it's late. And Mr. Naruhodo? Did you discover anything that may be of use to you in court tomorrow, do you think? Details about Mr. Shamspear, Mr. Gerdip's lodgings, the convict Selden? There are many facets to this case, and we're yet to see the heart of it, if you ask me. That's my feeling, anyway. I can't help but wondering about the results of the analysis. To Mr. Natsume's tea, you mean? Yes. Will they have found, strychnine in it or not? Well, I fear that either way. It'll be hard to escape the grip of our friend, Miss Reaper.
Oh, dear.
Yes, Bark Van Zeeks. But I wish you every success, of course. And though I was late to rise this morning... Tomorrow will be a new dawn. I intend to spring from my bed at a crisp hour and attend the trial.
Mr. Sholmes, you're going to come?
Indeed. Whatever happens, I shall be there, assuming my eyelids cooperate in the morning. Well, I think we've done all we can. All that's left is to remain focused and keep fighting for Mr. Natsume's cause until the very end. London, the world's most prosperous city. Home to some 6 million people. But away from the razzle-dazzle, down back alleys, and behind bricked-up windows, the lonely lurk. Sosuke-san had battled long and hard with loneliness during his many months here. And so I felt honor-bound to battle equally hard for my compatriot, to lift the curse that gripped him. As Mr. Sholmes said, tomorrow would be a new dawn, for all of us. To be continued. February 23rd, 9:23 a.m. The Old Bailey. Defendant's antechamber. Oh my gosh. His cat face.
This is it then, Mr. Naruhodo.
Yes, it's time to put an end to this now. To the miserable curse that's been plaguing Mr. Natsume. To everything. and in my own small way, I shall do everything I can to help you. I always appreciate your help, Miss Susato.
Suffering, Sosuke, selfishly, sidelined.
Ah. Good morning to you too, Mr. Natsume.
Good morning? Good morning. Welcome to Mr. Naruhodo Esquire. Listen to you two, chatting away happily as if the main player of today's trial isn't here. Why would you do that? Why?
Oh dear. We didn't mean to cause offense, Mr. Natsume. I thought perhaps that because you had your eyes shut so tightly, you were meditating, finding inner calm. It seemed wrong to disturb you.
I was waiting! What's the matter, Mr. Natsume? You seem different somehow today.
Why, naturally, that's because I've attained spiritual enlightenment. The path of literature, you see, is a journey to discover one's own death. Or such like. That's the sort of morning conversation I was hoping for. That's why I had my eyes shut.
I missed the signs, I'm afraid. Somehow, you'll have to forgive me.
You mustn't talk of your path leading you to death, Mr. Natsume.
This was just an example.
Oh, yes, there it is. Inner calm.
You barely convinced me at all yesterday. I was sure you'd abandon me and return to our beautiful, long-lost homeland.
We've not even been in Great Britain a week yet.
Yes, well, anyway. I intend to set everything straight in court today. I'm determined to uncover the truth.
I've actually reached an important decision myself.
Oh? What sort of decision?
I shall fill you in after the trial.
Alright.
It would seem Mr. Sholmes isn't coming today after all. It's a very clear message, I think. My dear fellows, you must win this battle on your own merits.
It's a very clear message, I think, that he's overslept again.
Great detective, my arch nemesis. Long may he stay away, if you ask me.
Defendant and your legal representative, the trial is about to begin. Make your way into the courtroom immediately.
Today, once again, we face the Reaper. When the Reaper stands for the prosecution, the defendant's fate is sealed. But I don't believe in that legend any more than I believe in Sosuke-san's curse. The truth is hidden here somewhere, and I won't let it escape me. I have to keep believing in my client and fight it to the very end, that's all. February 23rd, 9:40 a.m. The Old Bailey Courtroom.
In the name of Her Majesty the Queen, I hereby declare this court to be in session. I call upon the counsels of the prosecution and defense to declare their willingness to proceed. The prosecution is ready.
Yes, the defense is ready.
Very good. And now I call upon the six ladies and gentlemen of the jury, chosen by lot to represent the will of the people in this trial. Are you ready to proceed?
Absolutely. Justice will be done, you mock my words.
I feel obliged to say, I feel especially ruthless on days when my hat is sitting just right.
Oh, well, I wonder if you could adjust my hat for me, and please, be as ruthless as you like.
Thieves deserve to die, if you ask me, especially gas thieves. I have no sympathy for the man at all.
Look, I said it yesterday and I'll say it again now. I don't have time for this. I've got my own problems.
Oh, may the Lord show us all the light here, and lead his flock to a righteous verdict again today.
Now, Lord Van Ziegs, what can you tell us?
The prosecution's report, please, for the course. In relation to the theory expounded by the defense yesterday, regarding the defendant's chi.
So he does have the results. I don't think he, like, is actually, like, in the lore of vampire, but he definitely is, has the persona of one. It's that part is not very obvious, but I don't think he's a real, actual vampire.
Before the prosecution delivers the black news about the black tea belonging to the black guard in the dock, pray, allow me a moment to savor a liquid of a more sanguine hue. In fact, I'll defer to the good detective for the report. Here's to you, Inspector.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. As indicated by the defense, we found a bar of soap just outside the victim's window in the snow. There was indeed a frozen reddish liquid and a little depression on the top of it.
Yes, that's the tea. That's what Mr. Natsume brought with him that night.
Well, the brains at the yard analyzed it, and yes, you're right. It was tea. There wasn't a trace of strychnine or any other toxic substance in it.
No poison at all.
In other words, the tea that the defendant brought with him to the victim's room is innocent, is in the clear. What a revelation!
Oh yeah, points for us.
As I suspected.
This makes it quite clear. The defendant, Mr. Susuki Natsume, is...
My learned friend is jumping to conclusions again. A typical Nipponese reaction.
What?
Yes, it's true. No poison was found in the few drops of liquid recovered from the soap window... from the soap on the window ledge. But, what logic is that? Would you take a drop from the Thames and conclude that the water in the ocean is insulting you?
My word! The ocean, the water in the ocean is completely strong, is extremely salty, Counsel.
Exactly. Unfit for drinking, just as the victim's tea was on the night in question, as the court has already heard. Bitter was a precise word from the lips of Mr. William Shamspear, whom the prosecution now calls back to the stand.
Very well. I will uphold the prosecution's request.
Yep. He hates that lamp.
Mr. Shamspear.
Yes, it sounds like we're going to have another confrontation with our theatrical friend.
Bailiff, show Mr. Shamspear to the stand.
Mr. William Shamspear, the victim of this despicable crime.
Oh, heaven, oh, hell, do you command me to remember? Forsooth, 'twas I, Shamspear, did have a bellyful of foul fluid given in mine innocence.
Yes, but as was revealed in yesterday's proceedings, the witness is not as innocent as we had perhaps first been led to believe.
By using bars of soap such as this, he has been stealing gas from the supply company, yes.
One may smile and smile, and be a villain. Forsooth, 'twas I, Shamspear, did have a roomful of the sweet fuel given.
That's right, fellow jurors, don't forget. This man is a rotten thief. I haven't forgotten. Kept all that about the ice coins a tidy secret, didn't you? You should have shown up sooner. Owned up sooner.
Arrest him, I say. Arrest him at once. I can feel the sting in my tail. Oh, indeed. By dint of vile and cowardly means, have I plotted to further mine own ends? I confess. Thou would not pardon my sins. Of that, I am sure.
If you acknowledge your wrongdoing, what exactly are you doing here?
Cowards die many times before their deaths. And for a coward such as I, death be well deserved. But... would it that a still greater crime passeth unpunished? For lo, the hairy-faced gentleman of farther east than Verona did contrive to poison me.
But there was no poison in the tea found in your room. The police have attested to that.
What in defense would assert, as an inconsistency will quickly be cleared up by the witness's testimony. Is that not so, Mr. Shamspear?
Verily, my liege, I would most gladly speak.
Very well. Let the witness testify to explain this inconsistency. Tell the court why it is that poison apparently entered your body, though none was found in the tea.
The tea inconsistency.
The Japanese man did come to my chamber with tea brewed in a pot. It was in my cup alone that the wicked miscreant secretly poured his wicked poison.
whilst feigning distraction in our debate. Ne'er did a drop of his own drink pass his lips. When he departed by and by, I did use a tear that remained in his cup to make my coins of ice. Thus, 'tis no surprise that the poison be not found in the tea. I did pour into the moulds of soap.
The poison was slipped into the cup after the tea had been poured. The normal way for poison to be administered, in my experience.
Quite. Otherwise, it would be disastrous if the poisoner were to mix up the cups, for instance.
But no poison bottle was found at the scene.
Because, quite simply, the Nibbinese took the bottle back to his own room. The absence of a vessel containing the poison only becomes problematic when considering suicide.
Ugh. I knew that.
By now, it should be perfectly clear. A bar or two of cheap soap is wholly insufficient to wash the deep stains of guilt from the accused's minds.
Ugh. Sirs, madams, it is true that I, Shamsphere, be a common thief of gas.
But... what? Listen here, ladies and gentlemen.
Wherefore would I lie? Verily, I have no cause. I have naught to lose. Well, I do declare.
Thank you for your testimony, witness. Counsel, proceed with the cross-examination.
Yes, my lord. There's no staying. Kill the liar.
All right. I understand that you were already acquainted with Mr. Natsume, is that correct?
I know thee not, old man. Fall to thy prayers. Do I know thee, or know thee not? Methinks 'tis all I can know, that thy destiny mingles with mine.
You lost me at the first thee.
Zounds, sir. Thou must learn the English tongue afore thou turns thy hand into lawyering.
I did, but I must have missed the archaic Elizabethan lecture.
Verily, and in truth, 'twas a fine flavored brew, though a drop of poison did barb its sweetness, as a thorn doth barb the sweet rose. That, dear friends, be the simple truth. Listen to Mr. Shamsphere. He seems even better form than he was yesterday.
Either that, or I'm in worse form.
That fated evening, after I did dine at Grubb's Grubbery, a local alehouse of good report, naught did pass my lips but the tainted black tea. But behold, the poison was not in the tea at first.
Are you saying that you saw the moment when the poison was added to your tea?
To have witnessed the act and then drank the tea. Thou dost describe the actions of a fool.
Quite so, quite so. But no one likes going thirsty, do they?
Sooner would I die quenched than parched, would I have the choice.
Actually, on the night in question, the water main was frozen, I believe, wasn't it?
Were it not for the tea, in sooth I would sooner have died frozen than quenched or parched.
Right, no ice coins means no heating.
The wind has said more than one brush of death. With death on the night in question, it would seem.
Remind the court, Mr. Shamsphere, as to whether the accused drank any of the tea which he brought with him.
With the greatest of pleasure, my liege.
But the teacup Mr. Natsume drank from was found completely empty at the scene. Let's not forget the defense maxim, drink the tea while it's hot.
I did gulp from the poisoned cup that night, and in mine agony did I writhe uncontrolled. In fits of pain did I knock the fellow's cup, and its contents spilt as blood from a gaping wound, methinks. Though certainly, 'twas after I had made the coins of ice from his tea.
An upset cup was found on the table that the victim was slumped over. There is no contradicting here.
It's true, there is no tea left in either cup that we found at the scene. But still, something about this statement is troubling me. Yes, of course. I know what it is. It's Mr. Natsume's wise drink the tea while it's hot maxim, isn't it? No, I'm not sure that's it.
Thank you, witness. I reiterate for the court what it is that got occupied after your guest had left and before you drank your tea.
Yes, so that you could cheat the gas company, in fact. Isn't that right? To cheat, or to die, 'tis life's only choice. Yes. Faith, to cheat, be the wise choice, and mine occupation be not an ugly one. Prithee, dost... though not see beauty in the simplicity of the ruse? No, I don't. And be very sure, sir. Once this trial is over, Alamont Gas will take you to a task over this. Legal task. I shall not run. I shall not hide. Sooth to say, I have nowhere to run, nor to hide. But, my lady, what was thou with this pitiful player? Oh, I'll tell you what I'd like to do with you. Starting with a shoddy shirt on your back. This time for a Shamspare dance. What a harsh world we live in.
The thieving of the gas was addressed in yesterday's proceedings. Prosecution calls on the defense not to muddy the waters with irrelevancy. Consider that a warning, counsel.
Yes, my lord. Why am I the one in trouble here?
Mr. Shamspare, after the accused returned to his own lodgings, he used his tea to make your coins. Is that correct?
To cheat, or to die. Did I make my choice many moons ago? Hey, Ari, how long are you gonna stream? I'm probably gonna finish up soon just because it's getting late, so maybe, like, another 20 minutes or so. But we'll see where the story goes. I want to find a good spot to stop, as usual, so, yeah. Thus, it is no surprise that poison be not found in the tea I did pour into the molds of soap. If, having first made your special coins, it was after 2 a.m. when you collapsed. That would mean you can't have drunk any tea yourself until around that time. Once ensnared by literary debate, naught else be found in the furrows of the mind. The debate about Romeo and Juliet, you mean? And who was the stronger of the two? Rightly did I pay no heed to the tea as I wrestled with the abominable fellow. I don't remember debates like that when I was studying.
Are you suggesting that neither of you actually drank the tea whilst it was hot that evening?
My lord, wouldst thou be privy to some Shakespearean wisdom? Husband, wife, and tea, ought I tepid be? Ah yes, so very true. Everyone has different preferences when it comes to tea. I think you might have interpreted that wrongly. So it's been proven that there was no poison in Sosuke-san's tea. That could be hugely in our favor. But the atmosphere in this courtroom today... It feels as though everybody's against us, Mr. Naruhodo. It must be the Reaper's poison. I'm afraid that if we don't find a significant flaw in this testimony somewhere, the jury will pounce and find Mr. Natsume guilty. It really feels like we jumped in the fire here. Okay, so... Whilst feigning distracting our debate, Nier did a drop of his own drink past his lips. So we can present evidence here, which I think is the cups. And there's no ring inside of Mr. Natsume's cup because he drank it right away. We claim that Mr. Natsume didn't drink a drop of tea on the night in question. But that's impossible.
How? Chop logic? What is this, Hidok Eclad fiend?
The two teacups from the scene, one used by the victim and the other by the defendant, have a clear difference between them. One that represents incontrovertible proof.
Incontrovertible? What difference?
Look at the inside of the cups. Just here. There's a clearly visible ring.
Yes, a tea ring. commonplace enough. Indeed, such stains occur all too readily when one leaves tea in the cup for a while. And yet, Miss Onasimus' cup has no such ring.
Good lord, you're right. It's completely clean.
And prithee, sir, what makest thou of it?
Exactly what Mr. Natsume told the court yesterday. It's a Japanese saying he quoted.
Drink.
Tea. While it's hot.
That's right. Yes. The jittery Mr. Natsume was true to his usual self that night and drank his tea in no time.
Bah.
If, as you claim in your testimony, he didn't touch a drop of his tea, a ring would have developed on the inside of his cup as well, after the several hours of tea was left standing.
But...
In short, Mr. Shamspear, you clearly lied to the court.
To a nunnery!
As a rule, I fill my hallowed chalice up to 7 times during any one trial.
You might want to keep that information to yourself.
Yet on occasion, tedium distracts me and I pour more times than I intended to, until the bottle is dry.
Your drinking habits are fascinating, but irrelevant.
On the contrary, they illustrate the fickleness of human memory. To William Shamspear.
Yes, my liege.
Though you previously stated that you made the coin device from the left of a tea in the accused's cup, could it be that you were perhaps mistaken? Could it be that? Yes. Perhaps there was some tea remaining in the small teapot left at the scene. A fact that had vanished from your memory until now.
Faith, my liege, thou art a magician. For verily, 'tis as though thou hast seen with thine own eyes that night.
What?
Forsooth, I was mistook. I did plan to use tea from the Japanese fellow's cup, but lo, when I looked, 'twas empty. And thus did I use the dregs that festered in the teapot, as my liege did suggest.
And you've just suddenly remembered now that you made a mistake before? Are we supposed to believe that?
People's memories are imperfect, my learned friend. Which is why we rely on evidence instead. But in any case, it makes no difference. The victim's most recent testimony tells us 2 things of note. Firstly, the poison was put into the victim's teacup only. And secondly, that the spoiled cup was not the source of the insipid ice coins that have bewitched this court. The prosecution makes a fine summary of the facts. Furthermore, that testimony remains valid and in full support of the established facts. In other words... the inconsistency claimed by the defense simply does not exist.
No! What does this mean, then? I do declare it means there's no issue with the gas thief's testimony.
Apart from the bit about the thieving gas, obviously.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I do solemnly swear. After I did dine at Grubb's Grubbery Alehouse that night, naught did pass my lips. The black tea given me by the Japanese, whose back be stooped as low as death.
And on what did you dine, sir?
Why, I did partake of my favourites. A broth as wust be called soup, and a leaf as wust be called salad.
As insalubrious a menu as the establishment were, it was served.
But you gods will give us some faults to make us men. Willingly I would suffer that punishment 'tis seen fit to serve a wicked thief of gas, but... I pray ye wise and noble fellows, ne'er forget the simple truth. That be one thing, and this be another.
Jerusalem, you humble servant Shamspeare doth entreat you. Punish the Japanese fellow for his sins.
My lord!
If I may speak, my lord. Yes, Mr. Foreman. I believe we may have been duped by the rotten defense lawyer. By me?
I do declare you may be right. We all know the wife there was making coins of ice to keep himself warm.
But this lawyer, sir, lad, says if he's stealing gas, he deserves a dose of poison, eh? He's been leading us up the garden path, that's what he's been doing.
I really never said anything like that.
But what we just heard from the victim there has opened our eyes again. We've reached a decision this time, and we won't be swayed from it. The court acknowledges the position of the jury, Foreman. And we duly hear the jury's findings.
What? No, you can't yet.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you will state your decisions now.
Yuzai!
I hereby declare the jury to be in one accord.
Oh, happy day.
How is this happening?
My lord, the defense asserts his right to carry out a summation examination.
Very well. The court upholds the defense's right. Typical. My learned friend is unable to accept the obvious truth. This trial will therefore enter its second summation examination immediately. Jurors, the court calls upon each of you to state the grounds upon which you find the defendant guilty of the crime of which he is charged.
The jurors' contentions.
I'm a man of logic, me. Having considered all the evidence, the defendant must logically be guilty.
I do agree that gas is far too expensive. I can quite understand why the man would want to avoid paying. The stuff explodes, and it can poison you. It's absolutely lethal, gas is. Gas doesn't come for free. It costs a fortune to deliver it around the city and maintain the pipes.
Truth be told, the tea my wife serves up for me is a little sketchy at times. If nothing else passed the victim's lips at night, there's no other explanation, is there? I do feel that perhaps personal opinion about gas and its supply has influenced decision somewhat. But never mind.
No, you really shouldn't mind. Oh, excuse me.
The truth is, our counter-argument wasn't as unassailable as we'd hoped. And Mr. Shamspeare was poisoned. There can be no doubt about that. Then how are we supposed to turn this around? I think we need to establish the method by which Mr. Shamspeare was actually poisoned. Our only hope is to demonstrate that to the court incontrovertibly. But that's surely almost impossible at this stage. Oops. If we don't manage it, though, Mr. Natsume will be found guilty.
No delays, counsel. Proceed with the summation examination.
Jury examination. The defense's rebuttal. Defendant must logically be guilty. All the evidence, you say?
That's right. And there's no room for doubt. It's all pointing at that Japanese man with the big mustache.
Says the Englishman with the bigger mustache.
Which means we need to show the man some new evidence to make him change his mind.
If only we had that kind of evidence.
Don't worry, this summation examination has barely started, really. Perhaps there'll be a shift in the situation that shows an existing piece of evidence in a new light.
Let's hope so. To start with, though, I need to find some way out of this deadlock.
This isn't time or place to be discussing the price of gas, madam. What, really? Think of the injustice. Air is a gas, and air is free. Why should outmoded gas cost money? It
It makes my blood boil. I can feel myself becoming more ruthless than ever.
This isn't the time or the place to be ruthless either.
If I might interject here.
Yes, madam?
It seems my fellow juror takes issue with the price of our company charges for gas. But it's precisely because thieves like this man at the that the cost goes up. Oh, what a beastly man. That unkempt mustache, those hunched shoulders, poisoning tea and stealing gas. Utterly unforgivable.
No. Mr. Natsume isn't the one who's been stealing gas. I'll thank you not to go adding on more crimes.
Mr. Natsume hasn't been poisoning tea either. Well, anyway, I've quite made up my mind. It's as made up as the price of gas.
Oh my goodness, that lady. Could we please talk about the poison rather than the gas, do you think, sir?
Well, if you like. I mean, to be honest, I take poison over gas every time.
You'd take poison?
What I mean is, poison can only poison you. It doesn't explode, does it? Goodness me, what are you talking about? Set me straight, please, lawyer man.
Well, it's only true that poison isn't prone to exploding. But I think you'll find poison also can't light or heat up a room.
Oh, you're right. I hadn't considered that at all. Young lawyer man.
Yes?
You have a good head on your shoulders. I could use someone like you as our company's legal representative.
Well, I wasn't expecting to pick up more business in the middle of a trial, that's for sure.
Anyway, the point is, I haven't had the best experience with gas companies in the past. Gas doesn't come for free.
Can we please refrain from all the talk of gas?
It's not all that stack underway here, in case you hadn't noticed. Against my company's gas. I'm supposed to sit here and take it, am I? I don't think so.
She's really buzzing now.
All I've heard about are wonderful fuel, its explosions, and poisonings. What about electricity, hmm? What about getting electrocuted? What about that? A little explosion here and there is nothing in comparison.
Any explosion? Can only be described as nothing, madam. Nevertheless, the theft of your gas is deplorable.
My point exactly. The gas thieves aren't even the worst of our enemies. They are far more devious retrobates to contend with on a daily basis, you know.
More devious? Who, madam?
Other gas companies, of course.
Other gas companies? Not quite what I was expecting.
They generate gas and deliver it to our customers fair and square.
Indeed. Nobody's questioning that, madam. Alamont is an exemplary gas company.
There are other unscrupulous gas companies here in London that don't even have any gas at all.
What? But if they don't have any gas, how do they go about selling it to people?
You wouldn't think it possible, would you? But they steal our gas, you see, and sell that.
They steal your gas? How on earth is such a thing possible?
Gas companies like ours delivers gas to people's homes via a network of pipes. These devious reprobates secretly disconnect our pipes and divert our gas into their rotten pipes. Then they make a contract with the household supplied by those pipes and take money for the precious gas that's rightfully ours without us even knowing.
They're diverting gas into their own pipes illegally. What a brazen form of theft.
When we visit customers' houses to collect the money from their meters, we always have to check whether or not... whether or not one of these devious companies has been up to its trick.
Pursue. You have something to say about that, juror number 3.
Oh, golly. You mean me? I'm terribly sorry. I was just thinking to myself.
I really did catch him off guard there. Think about what the lady next to you was saying, correct?
Well, yes. I just got a little riled about it recently, you see.
Go on.
An Alamont gas worker visited my house the other day to investigate the pipework.
I need to ask for your cooperation while we carry out a secret check of your property, sir, the fellow said. So I let him in.
And do you know what he did?
I'm afraid I have no idea. Please tell us.
He proceeded to take one of my lights off the wall. And then he grabbed the exposed mouth of the pipe and started blowing into it.
What do you think you're doing, young man? You're giving away company secrets there.
Oh, please, everybody knows. But it was nearly the death of me, I can tell you.
What do you mean?
I'll explain, if you don't mind. As I said before, those unscrupulous other gas companies connect their customers to our pipe network.
Yes, but how does blowing into the pipes come into it?
Obviously, there's gas in the pipes, and that's at a fairly low pressure. By blowing air through the pipe, we can make the pressure drop temporarily. And if you do that, any lights connected to the same pipe will flicker for a moment.
Ah, I see. In other words, if upon blowing into the pipe, the lights of an adjacent property that has no contract with your company flicker, you can know that these devious scoundrels have been meddling with the pipes.
Exactly, my lord. That's it, in a nutshell. That's the reason why we have teams of workers going around neighborhoods to investigate which lights flicker. The trouble is, a particular worker who came by my house didn't know the strength of his own breath. He blew down the pipe with all his might, and you can guess what happened, can't you?
Well, if he blew hard, then...
Wait, you mean... That's right. The lights didn't just flicker, they went out. Along with the stove, gas started pouring into the house.
Oh, what a disaster.
The gas supply must have been interrupted briefly because the man blew too hard, so the flames went out. I'm afraid I yelled at the fellow. Are you trying to kill us all, I said?
So, by disconnecting a lamp and blowing into the exposed gas pipe, it's possible to extinguish lamps and stoves, connected to the same network of pipes. And then when the gas starts flowing again, it just silently seeps into the room.
Mr. Naruhodo, I think perhaps...
Yes, this is almost certainly the clue that we've been hoping for. Juror number 3, the defense requests that you amend your statement to include that information.
Oh, well, if you like. I don't mind. Well, I do. That's our company's secret method of identifying the rogues that tried to diddle us. Like I said, madam, it's widely known already.
Very well. Juror number 3, you'll amend your statement accordingly.
Yes, my lord. Although I'm not really sure what the point of all this is.
Blow too hard into a gas pipe and you extinguish everything in the house, and then you're in real trouble. Okay. And you extinguish everything in the house. I guess we could press on this statement. When you say extinguish everything in the house, do you mean even on different floors?
Oh yes, all the floors connected to the same- All floors are connected to the same pipe after all. That's true of every building. Because gas supply contracts are issued for whole properties.
Well, I had no idea that it was possible to extinguish gas appliances simply by blowing down the pipe.
That's not something we like to publicize, to be honest. We have to carry out these investigations, as I'm sure you can appreciate.
Indeed. It has been mentioned on more than one occasion, in the papers even. Is that so? It's been mentioned to me too, very recently. An incident involving gas stove going out inexplicably, almost leading to someone's death.
Mr. Naruhodo, I think perhaps?
Yes, it's finally starting to fall into place. The secret link that joins all of these strange occurrences. Okay. So we need to pit this against something else. I think we can finish pressing all the statements here.
You mean it's poisoned? That's right. It's happened a tidy few times now. This is most troubling indeed. It's always a day like this one when I don't get any wages. I get in at tea time, see? And I see her doing it. My wife. She gets that devilish look on her face. And then she slips some white powder into my cup.
And you drink it anyway?
I was brought up proper, I was. If someone gives you a cuppa, you drink it.
And what happened to you? What did it taste like?
It was god-awful, believe you me. Salty as a...
Then, I think perhaps what your wife put in your tea... was salt.
No! So, she doesn't even care enough to poison me properly, eh? Unbelievable.
Let's move on, please.
Does that mean if the victim could be shown to have ingested something else, you change your leaning?
Sorry? What's that now?
I was just saying, if the victim did actually eat or drink something else on the night...
What's the matter with you?
Sorry?
I said, if nothing else passed the victims that night, there's no other explanation, is there? Haven't you been listening to me at all?
I feel there's an English expression about a pot and a kettle that's appropriate here. Compared to the other jurors, who don't even appear to have anything to say about the case at all. It would seem that this elderly gentleman has been listening to the proceedings far more intently.
I suppose. The trouble is...
He has selective hearing? Exactly. But still, this juror may be well the key to the breakthrough that we so desperately need. This is hopeless. There's no way for me to appeal to these people. I do think that the only way we shall overcome this difficult situation is by exposing the way Mr. Shamster was really poisoned. We have to prove that it happened some other way, and not via Mr. Natsume's tea.
Yes, I know. The trouble is, I have absolutely no idea how it did happen.
Mr. Naruhodo, I wonder if perhaps there's something you might have forgotten.
Oh, like what?
It's important to watch everyone involved and pursue people if they react to something someone else says. If you'd like to remind me exactly what I mean, I'd be more than happy to, of course. Once again, Tosuke-san's fate is entirely in my hands here. Probably owe it to my client to hear any advice my assistant may be able to offer. So perhaps I ought to let Susato-san remind me. Then again,
we're good.
Actually, I don't think there's any need. It's vital that we start trying to change these jurors' minds as soon as possible.
Of course, I'm sure you're right. But if you decide you would like your memory fresh, you need only ask, Mr. Naruhodo.
Now the poor guy has to continue drinking salty tea. That's pure evil. Okay. I want to keep playing, but it's late, and I should probably go to sleep, but... I'll try to continue playing tomorrow, and I feel like, if we get past this part, then it's probably going to be a while before we get to a good place to stop. So, we'll stop here for now, and then, we'll solve this, summation examination, next time. But yeah, I'll save here, and then, we will, finish the stream for today. I want to keep playing though, but it's late. Okay. But yeah, thank you all so much for watching. Oh, I didn't mean to press that. But thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you on the next one. Goodbye.